Hi, I'm Michael Zalapsky, and Rahul Chakraborty was asking about these images from Sketch's blog. He says, does anyone know how to make these? Then Lucas Pitter said, hey, I bet you could do this with Trapcode Form. I didn't look at anything else. I just dove right in and I made this. After I finished, I looked back at what Lucas actually did in Trapcode Form, and I thought, hey, that's some pretty good ideas there too. So I'm going to show you how to make these images, mixing my techniques and Lucas's together. So come along with me, let's make some cool stuff. So we're here in After Effects, and we'll start off with a new comp. Let's make it, 20 seconds long. And we'll bring in our music track, which we'll be using later, and press LL to reveal the waveforms. Move it along to somewhere around here, I guess. All right, it's a fun little track. And we'll start off with some Trapcode Form. We'll make a new solid layer, Control Y to make a new solid layer. And we will name this layer right off. We'll name it Form. I always like to give a label to my layers so I can keep them organized. And to this layer, we will apply Trapcode Form. Now, Trapcode Form is a particle system, but instead of having particles that born and die, it lives eternally. You can actually do this technique in Trapcode Particular, because Trapcode Particular has all the power of form in it. Since we're just using basic form techniques, I figure we just use form. First of all, for our base form, we do not want a grid. We want it to be strings. And we only want one layer of strings, because our graphics are, one layer worth of strings. But we're going to want to change our size in X here, and probably somewhere around 2000. And base form Y will probably be, around 1200 or so. We'll mess with those as need be. We don't need so many strings, probably around 30 or so will be fine. Now, we want to move these particles based on another layer. We're going to be using the layer maps here in form to push around and change the look of our particles. So let's tuck our form away for now. And let's just do a real basic shape layer. Making sure no layers are selected, we're going to pick our star tool and double click it. This will bring us up a shape layer with a star in it. We don't want any of it poking off the end. I kind of want all the shapes to stay inside here. So I'm gonna make the outer radius a little bit smaller here. As well as the inner radius to keep having a nice star shape. And we want to have, you can do whatever you want for your project, but I want a nice clear line. So I'm going to do outer stroke, having a solid color on our stroke color here, and no fill at all. And you know what? I'm going to give it 4 points instead of the 5 that it starts with. And you know what? I'm going to twirl down the polystar path here real quick and mess with our inner roundness, putting it up to, say, 220 or so, to kind of get more of a unique little shape there. I kind of like that shape. Now, to make it work, if I solo the layer and show you the transparency grid, we've got just white and then nothingness. We need this to be a black and white map for what we're wanting to do. In our effects and presets, let's look for solid composite. What solid composite does is it fills in the alpha of your layer with a color of your choosing. And we are going to pick full on black for this one. And then we're going to want some sort of fall off here. So let's just do a fast box blur. A few pixels here, just a little. And that'll be our starting point. Let's hide this layer. In fact, let's bring up our form layer again. Hide our transparency grid. And on our form layer, go into the layer maps and let's work on moving this around. Now, in my example, I had it moving on Y up and down, but in Lucas's example, he's moving it in Z and tilting the base form back some. And I think that might be a cool look. So I'm going to do that for this tutorial here. Let's move it back, about 24 or so, 30, somewhere in that range. And we might need to make our base form move up just a little bit to fill in that space. Maybe be a little bit wider as well. Maybe a little taller. I don't know. Find the values that work for you with how you're doing your look. We want to point our displacement functionality. We want to go individual X, Y, Z, because we're only wanting to push them out on Z. And our layer for Z is going to be our shape layer with its effects and masks. And we're going to say map it over X and Y. since we've only got particles in X and Y. That's the way to go. Now you can see already we've got our particles dipping down. We want to go the other way, so let's go minus 50. So there we go. We've got our lines and our particles bumping up. But in our examples, they also change their size. So the lines are thin here, then thicker as they go over the top. So for that, we will go into our particle size, and we're going to make it a little bit bigger. Let's go somewhere around 8 or so, I think would be good. Maybe 10. We'll mess with this later and see how we like to look at things. Now you can see here, if I zoom in, you can actually see the particles where it's getting pushed over this edge here. So under our string settings, let's bump that density up. Let's double it to like 30. That'll make it a lot more particles be forming those strings there. All right, let's zoom back out and take a look. Now we need the size to be affected by our shape layer as well. So under our layer maps, under size, we will also say, go to that shape layer with its effects and masks, and we'll map it over X and Y. Now right away, you'll see a problem. It completely disappears. That's because black is, it's full black, so it goes fully gone. And we don't want that. So let's apply a tint effect here to our layer, our driving layer, and let's make it somewhere around 30 or 40%. That way we still get the bump that we need, but we still get to see the lines somewhat. And I think I also want these to be not as visible. I want the opacity to be affected by this as well. So under our layer maps, under color and alpha, we will say, hey, lightness to alpha on, and we'll use the same shape layer with its effects and masks and map it over X and Y again. So now we have about, 40% opacity, full opacity. Now, let's add a solid composite to our form layer as well. Let's say make it black. And we're going to want to change the color. So we'll also add a tint effect. And we want to be able to have full control over the colors. So you can make the background be whatever color you want. I'm going to keep it full black for now. But I'm going to make the white maybe kind of a greeny color. I think that's nice. And I'm keeping it away from being full green. So if I go all the way up here, I've got nothing in red. But I want to have some colors everywhere, so that it will glow nicely. Speaking of glowing nicely, let's add some optical glow to this. And you can already see we've got a nice look going on here. I might want only the highlights to be glowing some here. And I'm going to make the size a little bit bigger. And maybe the fall off have some more oomph to it. So you get that kind of nice look there. Now keep in mind, this is all being driven by this layer map. So if I rotate, for example, my shape, we get kind of a neat look. It goes along with it just exactly the way we want. And again, I'm rotating the star shape, not the layer. So that's basically all I had to do to get the basic overall look of things. Now, if you want to have the fall off be a bit of a different shape on here on the shape layer, you could add, say, a curves effect here and maybe crunch up the highs and push down the lows. And have a bit more control over the shape of how this goes up and down. And remember, this layer here is affecting everything. You can put the curves above the tint and have the tint be the final say, or you can have the curves be after the tint. Have a little more control. It's really, again, up to you. So we've got the overall look that we want, but we want to get this animating in time to our music that we have here. So we're going to bring in another solid layer here, and we're going to be applying Trapcode Sound Keys to this layer, because we're going to use sound keys to drive our animation. So it happens in time at the beat. We pick our audio layer, it's going to be our music layer. And we can see here already, it's reacting to the music. I think we're going to do probably this bass beat here. So in range one, which is active, if I have the effect selected, you can actually see your control points. I'm going to pick that lower tone to be our thing, and I hit play and we'll see how it responds. This will show you range one. And if you enabled range two, which you can set, you can have it with three ranges, but we only need the one for our beat. And this will give us the feedback from what's happening. It's pretty good. So we've got our beats happening. Like it's giving us the data we want. I'm going to say we probably don't want 0 to 100. We'll just do 0 to 1. And I don't want the fall off to be instant, which means the number will just go up to a max of 1, down to a minimum of 0, back and forth. We don't want that. We want it to be constantly incrementing. So every time that bass hits, we want to go a little bit more, because we're going to have it rotate a bit each time the bass hits, instead of rotating, going back. So instead of fall off being instant, we want it to be none integrate. Now that means it's going to go up to a max of 1 and then stay there as it goes down. And then when it bumps up, it's going to go, and it's going to just keep incrementing, is what none integrate means. So when I hit apply there, and let me name this layer sound keys, and I'll make it a nice purple color. Sound, if I hit U, you say, hey, we've got keyframes now across this whole thing. And I'm going to alt click on the rotation for our shape and going to point it to the output of the sound keys. So every time that sound goes up, solo our shape layer here, we can see that every time it beats, it moves every time that beat hits. But hit EE to reveal our expression, which again, I didn't really type anything. I just pick whipped down to this value, but I want to be moving more each time. Not very complicated. I'm just going to multiply it by, I don't know, let's say 10 and see how that goes. So this keyframe value times 10, and we'll see how it looks. All right, that's all right. I think that'll work for now. So let's unhide that, and we'll be looking back at our thing again, moving time to the beat. If you want it spinning the other way, you can multiply it by negative 10. Now, one more thing that I did was I applied Magic Bullet Looks to give it a bit of kind of noise and grain. You hit edit here on looks. We'll dive into the look builder. I'm gonna click on tools to make these tools stay open. And I really only want two tools. I'm gonna scroll down here to our film section. Let me zoom in real close so you can see what I'm about to do. I'm gonna add some halation and renoiser. Fold those tools back up. For halation, it emulates what happens when light bounces off the back of a film goes through. I'm gonna pick modern 35. If I turn it off and on, you'll see it just adds just a little hint diffusion to things. Let me turn off the renoiser, might be able to see it even a little better. And if I want to be more extreme, I can show you the vintage 35 adds that just that little bit of extra detail. You know, I'm going to leave it on vintage 35. And then for renoiser, which is a great film grain emulator, I'm going to go modern 35. It just helps break up these gradients that happen in the glow, which means when it gets compressed, you won't have banding, but it also adds a nice warm naturalistic flavor to things. And then last of all, to get a look that Lucas did, he had a bit of depth of field going on. So let's add a camera so we can get some depth of field. 50 millimeters should be good. And then hit AA to reveal our camera properties. I'm going to say turn depth of field on and crank the aperture way up. Maybe even more than that. And you get kind of a cool out of focusy look there. Let me turn down the optical glow. I think I may be going a little too hard now. So there you go. If I turn that off, you can really see we got like the one spot in focus and everything goes out of focus. It's a little extreme, but I just kind of want to show it off. You can do a lot of cool things with this. And one thing I did not mention earlier is that there is another way to get it to react to audio besides just using sound keys. Trapcode Form has its own audio react function. So I'm going to say, hey, audio layer is going to be our sound layer. And our first reactor is going to be mapping to... let's say to the fractal. And under our fractal field settings, we can say, hey, we want it to displace, you know, a certain amount.
And then under our audio react, this fractal layer, we're going to say, I think it's going to have a bit of a delay, 0.2.
And then you can see, wow, we've got quite a bit going on there. My fractal settings may be a little too far there. Let's displace maybe like 30. We'll try 30. And we'll see how it goes.
Oh yeah, that's way too much. Let's do maybe like 10.
There you go. You got a little bit of a ripple going across your scene there. But again, for the look that you're going for, you do what you want to do. Here with this audio reaction, you can have it going X from left to right. You can have it going outwards, top to bottom, all kinds of things. Let's try X outwards. I think that might be a good one for this option, and we'll give that a go. So it's a pretty neat look, and I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. And if you make something cool with it, please share it with Red Giant so we can take a look.